Hello, hello, all of you. So today we are going to start container as a service. We already seen platform as a service in previous lecture and in unit 2. Here in container as a service, we'll study the case of Docker Hub. So first of all, we have to understand the basics. Basic is about OS level virtualization. There are various levels of virtualization: hardware level virtualization, OS level virtualization, application level virtualization. So here, OS level virtualization. So what does it mean? It means the virtual image is being created just like a real computer, and you can have program running over it. And how it runs? It runs with the help of first phenomenon is defined as container, that we are going to study in detail. Second phenomenon is zones or partitioning. Then third, fourth phenomenons are virtual private servers, virtual environment, virtual kernels. So these zones, partitions, virtual private servers, virtual environment, virtual kernels, all are not in the scope of this part. Only we are going to see containers in detail. So what OS level virtualization do? OS level virtualization do virtualization of all resources, such as devices connected to for that programming that you want to run, files and folder that you want to use, network sharing, it manages, CPU program powers, it manages, quantifiable hardware capacity. And these things are being controlled by the containers and OS level virtualization. So the program that you want to run on the container can only see the content that or the devices that you had assigned for that container. Rest of the outer world of the container remains safe and secure. So the container basically refers to the OS level virtualization, and this all example of all these things is Hyper-V. Then container basically have is a contain is an image. So container image is there, which actually running process and interact like a private environment, and private file system would be created for that container image. Then the container image actually runs an application that actually have code or binary information. Then running runtime dependency means all those dependencies, the libraries or functionality that are being needed by that program would be used by that code as the dependency. Then thereafter, the file system basically have objects that are being created and that are being used. Then the Docker is one of the platform that actually helps you do the system administration, that could do development part. For example, building a program, building and running the program, and then sharing that application with others. So that type of things are being done at the Docker container. Then Docker Hub is basically a kind of container as a service. It was introduced by Solomon and Sebastian. Then OS level virtualization basically delivers software in package called container. So that's the basic of the OS level virtualization is basic of the container. So host container is called Docker engine. So you deploy your application at Docker engine. You deploy your container at Docker engine. Then Docker can have packages that are being required by your application. And these packages would contain dependency. What are dependency? Dependencies are libraries that you import, that you include in your container that would be required for running your code. And that virtual container basically runs over any operating system, and basically Linux servers are being used for this Docker container. Then container basically have the isolated property that one container is isolated from another container is isolated from rest of the container. So these containers are independent from each other, and they bundle whatever the software library and configuration files are being required. Then all containers can run on a single operating system, and therefore they use fewer virtual resources as compared to the virtual machine. So container uses less amount of resources as compared to virtual machines. We'll see later this in detail. So what is the advantage and what are the properties of the Docker Hub? Basically in the computational reproducibility. So Docker can implement and deploy some container. This is good thing. We already know this. Now, what type of advantage it provides? It provides advantage of cross-platform portability. Means you could run on Windows, you can run on macOS, you can run on Linux. The application is being deployed at Docker engine. So Docker engine is like a web application. You can run that Docker container from any platform. Then modular component reusing and sharing. So basically what it does, it do modular and component based development. That's why you basically import various libraries, includes various files. So these are being helpful for reusing and sharing. Then Linux container basically has some OS level virtualization. So this Linux container are being used for this OS level virtualization. Thereafter, there is a portable across platforms. It is this Docker is basically portable across platforms. We already discussed this in part that you can run on any from any operating system, and you can use any feature of any operating system for running your application. Then achieving and archiving and versioning of the container. So Docker provides you facility of creating various versions of your own application, and you can put your application to the archive. Then dependency and coupling. This dependency and coupling is the part of software engineering. This is the most basic part of the programming features that you have to understand before you go to the Docker. So this dependency and coupling is the most fundamental part of container. What dependency and coupling means? So it's dependency means you have interdependency and relationship between the software modules. Means there are many modules that you can't create. And it because they need specific skills and specific requirement, and that all requirement could be met by someone else, and he created or she created that application and module. Thereafter, you just want to use that module in your application, so you just import that library or include that library. So what it does, it means your program or application is dependent on the and related to the previous development done by someone else as the software modularity. Then what three properties that you have to understand about this? So connected two or more routines or modules. Basically, at least two modules should have to be connected so that there should be interdependency. So two or more routines or modules are connected. Then second, coupling can be low or loose, high or tight. Someone says low coupling, someone says loose coupling. Both are same. Someone says high coupling, someone says tight coupling. Both are same. So coupling means how much interdependency of one module over the another module. So that is coupling. If there's too many interdependency, then it is tight or high coupling. If there is only few dependencies, then low coupling, loose coupling. low coupling basically provides well structured and good design of software. So low coupling is expected by the software engineers, that well structured coupling should have to be there. Then disadvantage of high and tight coupling. So you have to understand what are the disadvantage of high or tight coupling. So basically there is a change in one module, means you change one module, then another dependent module has to be changed. It has to be forcefully be changed, or it has to be tested whether the functionality is working fine or not. So change in one module makes you change another module. Then modularity basically requires effort or time. So, and that all depend on the inter-module dependency. So modularity basically requires effort and time to manage the inter-module dependencies. Then harder to reuse means it takes too much effort to reuse and test a module, because there are too much dependency. There are too many dependencies. So it becomes hard for another module to be reused or to be tested, because there are too many dependencies. Then you have basically modularity requires various effort and time. It's the second point that we'll discuss. So dependency, high dependency creates management, that whether the regression testing should be done better, more efforts are required if there is too many inter-module dependent. So I hope that three disadvantages of high and tight coupling is being clear to you. Then performance reduction by the message and parameters. This is the important thing. What are the disadvantages of message passing for the high or tight coupling? That basically request and response requires messages to be transferred, and that requires CPU and memory. How much messages are being passed and to be transferred, that has to be requiring more amount of CPU and memory. Then message creation, transmission of that message, translation of that message, marshaling and interpretation, string array and data structure, all these things are required for management of that message. That message creation, transmission, translation, interpretation, all these requires effort, and that reduces the performance of message and parameter passing. Then Docker image. So Docker image basically resolve these issues of dependencies. So we had seen what is expected. Low coupling is expected for the well-structured software. And we want to avoid high or tight coupling, because we already know the disadvantage of high or tight coupling. Then we will see Docker image basically resolve this type of dependencies. How they basically resolve this type of dependencies? They are working on the Linux system, and Linux compatible softwares are being included, like R, Python, MATLAB. So you have to, and other programming environment like Java, C are being included in the Docker and Docker image. So the Docker image, basically you have not to worry that what are the new features or new software things are being dependent. So because Docker automatically manages, and the backend team of Docker manages all these things. So Docker image and virtual image, there is comparison between the two things, Docker image and virtual machine image. So what is the similarity? So similarity is that both of them resolves the dependency issues, and both virtual machine and Docker image pre-install all the binary requirement or dependencies, or it imports and includes the files that are required for your software to run. So this is similarity and good thing about both Docker image and virtual machine. What is dissimilarity and what is advantage of Docker image? So advantage of Docker image and dissimilarity with virtual machine, this is important, that Docker image basically shares Linux kernel with the host machine. So Docker image shares Linux kernel with the host machine. So it avoids what? Overhead of resources that are required by the virtual machine. So we'll see this thing later, that how sharing Linux kernel with the host machine is an advantage for the Docker image. In the 2-3 slide, we'll see how it becomes advantage of Docker image. So just remember this point, Docker image basically shares Linux kernel with the host machine. So what happens? The host machine is there, it is running, and basically you assume practical laptop or server is running infrastructure level, and you have Linux installed over it, and Docker image directly communicate with that Linux kernel, and it removes the middleware hindrance. What is done by the middleware, like VirtualBox, VMware, these are the middleware that actually install the operating system over the another host operating system. But here Docker image directly connect with the Linux kernel. So it skips the barrier and Docker image works little faster. So Docker file basically do what? Docker file basically helps you build the image, and it automatically help you do the reading the instruction, and basically in the structure of that Docker image, Docker file is a file that is very important, and Docker file basically have written the commands for the user that can call various command line argument, and that actually install an image. The Docker file is a text document that contains various commands. So in the whole package of that container, there's one file, Docker file, that contains various commands, and that command line arguments are there, and that installs the image of your container over the Docker engine. So it is a command line file which contains various command line arguments. So Docker basically builds and creates automatically based upon various command lines that you had mentioned in the instruction of inside the Docker file. So in the, you prepare the Docker file, and in that Docker file you mention various command line arguments, and these command lines are being executed by Docker. How it been executed by the Docker? So Docker basically builds an application based upon the Docker file. It search on some path, it search that Docker file, and it builds that Docker image with the help of Docker file. Then copy and paste or pull this image. So basically what you want to do, if you created Docker image on your own laptop or your own machine, then you basically push that image to the server, or basically what you can do, if you deployed some image over the Docker engine, so you can pull that image to the Docker engine. Or suppose you deployed had created a project on GitHub. So on the GitHub, you basically do what? You created the project on GitHub, then with the GitHub and Docker Hub automatically provides you feature that you can deploy, or you can create a container of that GitHub repository directly on the on the Docker engine. So basically, you want to pull the hello world for the execution of hello world, which is deployed at Docker engine, and you want to execute that hello world on your own laptop. So that is Docker pull. And these are just very small commands. There are hundreds of commands like this. So you can go and study. Then Docker concept basically have these features: flexibility, lightweight, portable, loosely coupled, scalable, secure. So basically Docker containers can be deployed as an application, and this whole process is being said as containerization. How it is flexible? It is basically complex application that has the container. So the complex application is there, means it's very too many dependencies are there, so these can be containerized. Then lightweight are there, so basically container leverages and shares host kernel. So container is basically shares the host kernel, and that makes it lightweight. What does it mean, a lightweight? It do not need overhead of another middleware, so it becomes faster to directly communicate with the host OS and directly execute that container image. And it makes all these things manage efficient resource management. Whereas in the virtual machine, you first install Linux operating system on host machine, and on top of that you install VirtualBox or VMware like middleware, and on that middleware you install another operating system, so that guest operating system first contact with the VirtualBox or VMware, that middleware, and that middleware further communicate with the host operating system. So the one layer of connection is being reduced. Portable, you can easily build and deploy over the cloud, and you can run from anywhere. So that is portable, means you, once you deployed, you go to another city, it execute same as the previous city. You go to another city, it execute, because it's on internet, so it is same everywhere. Then loosely coupled, container basically have highly self-efficient, and they allow replace and upgradation of the various applications. So what it means? It means loosely coupled means it tries to avoid too much coupling. And when you want to upgrade an application or you want to replace that application, so less amount of dependency on the another module would be there. So it's good to have loosely coupled. Then scalable environment. So basically distributed container replicates across the data center. So it is scalable, means it could use many infrastructure, and secure things are there, means one container is isolated from another container. So the constraint and isolation is there, and the process can run without configuration, and it requires the part of users, and thus it's better to use isolated container and security. Then container and virtual machine. So this is exact comparison of container and virtual machine with the image as well. So container basically runs natively, means it directly share and communicate with the host machine and host operating system. So it directly communicate with the host machine, so it's better, and it does not use any middleware or any guest operating system. So container is better. So container directly runs as a discrete process, means a separate process is been running, and it is taking less memory for execution. Thereafter, we'll see second figure, VM runs fully dependent on guest operating system. So virtual machine is dependent on operating system with respective hypervisors and the host resources. Then the VM virtual machine basically uses the all resources of the guest operating system. So you need more resources to run virtual machine. And in the container, you need only application A or application B to be run. And that directly uses binary library, and the Docker directly communicate with the Linux kernel. So I hope that you have understood that hypervisor layer is being removed by the Docker. So these are the two stacks. I hope this would be clear to all of you that container has various application that uses binary or libraries that actually through Docker directly communicate with the host operating system. Whereas virtual machine has various application running and that uses binary or library files that communicate with guest operating system. Guest operating system would communicate with the hypervisor. Hypervisor further communicate with the host operating system or directly with the infrastructure. So there are two type of hypervisor. One is bare metal deployment and another one is dependent on host operating system. So this is bare metal deployment in the right hand side figure. Then these are the commands for build and run of your Docker image. So you basically pull the and clone that GitHub repository that you had created. So node bulletin board is the repository that you had stored at the GitHub on your Docker sample. Docker sample is the path for the repository. Repository name is node bulletin board. So you basically change the directory for that building and installing of that repository. So after that, when you change the directory, you came to the directory of your own, then you basically built that bulletin board application or container, and then you publish that bulletin board application or repository on the Docker Hub or Docker engine, and you can execute it through, and you can run that application through the Docker itself. Then you have to understand why platform as a service or why container as a service. This is important thing. When to use PaaS and when to use CaaS. So various programming tools and various deployment tools are there. Various application hostings are there. So you have to understand that these three things are different. Programming tools are different. Deployment tools are different. Application hostings are different. So these are the three things that you have to understand. These three things are different from each other. This is the important thing that you have to understand as a prerequisite to understand PaaS and CaaS. Once you understand that these three things are different, then that will be fine. What are programming tools? Programming tools are NetBeans, Eclipse. So you can develop an application. So development tools are different. You import some libraries. There are various libraries. Jar files are there. Include files are there. That are deployment tools. There are various containers are there, like Tom Apache, Tomcat, or Glassfish. So these are deployment tools. Then third one is application hosting. Application hosting is like where do you want to host that application? On the Windows operating system, Apache Tomcat, you want to host that application. On the Linux, on the Glassfish server, you want to deploy that application and host that application. So how you want to manage that application? That is third thing. Once you understand these three things, you'll understand what is cache and patch. So cache basically include a stack of tools for deploying the container. And cache do not include development tools. So what cache includes? Cache only includes deploying container. So containers that are required for the deployment are being used, and whatever libraries are being used, only these are being used. Then cache do not basically include development environment, means it does not contain anything like NetBeans, it does not contain anything like library. Then cache is basically subset of platform as a service functionality. So patch has the larger functionality and cache has the smaller functionality. Patch is the larger functionality. It has development environment as well. So in the patch, you can develop as well, you can deploy as well. But in cache, you can only deploy. In the container as a service, you can only deploy application. Then cache is basically main use case is to containerize the application. What container as a service wants to do? Only containerize an application. Then cache is basically incomplete form of patch. So you can say platform as a service is a larger thing, and cache is just subset of patch functionalities. So cache is basically incomplete. If you want to develop some application, you cannot develop on cache. Then patch and cache use case. So I hope that you already know the use cases now. So the patch basically do the integrated solution for development as well as deployment of an application. Means it contains all three things: programming tools, deployment tools, application hosting tools. So platform as a service contains all three of the things that we had discussed. Container as a service cache has only setup and management activities of that container and its environment. So what are libraries are being required? What are the imports you want to do? What are the system commands that you want to execute? What are the other external libraries that you want to call, modules that you want to call? What are the graphic features you want to use? So all these environments are being managed by the container as a service. So you have benefit of both the things, platform as a service as well as container as a service. Both the things have their own benefits. If you want development and you want to develop some application, then you should go for the platform as a service. If you want to develop some application, then go for the platform as a service. Sorry. So if you have some pre-developed application or you want to make an application in the public hosting and you want to deploy that application publicly, then you go for the container as a service. So both the things, container as a service and platform as a service, have their own advantage and disadvantage. So you have to check whether your application or requirement fits better to which kind of service. Then next, what are the patch and cache hybrid? So both the things could be mixed. Patch and cache could be mixed, and both the development and deployment environment and container could be mixed together. So there are three application well known, which are mixture of patch and cache. So Amazon Elastic Container Service is there. Ruby on Rails Engine Yard is there. Google App Engine. So these three things are itself requires too much detail to study. So these are the hybrid of patch and cache. Then in the next class, we'll discuss software as a service and distributed version controlling system. So I hope that you have enjoyed. And if you have any question, then you may ask. Or we'll finish up here. Okay, then thanks. Bye.